As a tree surgeon, rock climber, and emergency rescue trained firefighter, I spend a lot of time hanging out in harnesses. While each of these activities has their own inherent risks, they also share one, the risk of suspension trauma. Suspension trauma occurs when the body is suspended vertically, usually in a safety harness, and remains relatively motionless over time. This can happen after a tree limb unexpectedly breaks, leaving a tree worker dangling, or a rope anchor detaches from a boulder and leaves a climber stranded mid-air. Being vertically suspended like that allows excess venous blood to begin to pool in the lower extremities, and over time this pooling means that less blood makes its way back towards the heart. This can result in deoxygenated tissues, presyncopal symptoms like dizziness or lightheadedness, loss of consciousness, and ultimately death. While the number of deaths due to suspension trauma is small, understanding how suspension trauma symptoms develop and how their onset can be reduced or delayed is important, particularly for firefighters and other emergency service workers who may have only minutes to save someone's life. By being involved in multiple activities in which suspension trauma is a risk, it became clear to me that recommendations for treating potential suspension trauma victims are inconsistent at best and lack adequate data to support mitigation recommendations. One recommendation, used by tree surgeons primarily, is to use the W position to combat shock. This position places the victim in the relative shape of a W, with the knees drawn up to the chest to keep blood from pooling in the lower legs. While it's most commonly used when the victim is on the ground and leaning against a wall, use of the W position while the victim is in suspension hasn't actually been verified yet in clinical practice. So, as only anecdotal evidence exists, I felt it was important to investigate the question, does aerial use of the W position increase time to onset of pre-suspension trauma symptoms or minimize pre-suspension trauma symptoms experienced by participants? In essence, if a victim is put into the W position, will it stave off development of symptoms that ultimately result in suspension trauma overall, or at least delay symptom onset long enough that rescuers can reach and rescue them? In my experiment, participants hung in rock climbing harnesses at the University of Birmingham climbing wall in either the interventional W position, displayed on the left, or in the neutral control position, displayed on the right. Participants' heart rates, blood pressures, oxygen saturations, pain ratings, and the amount of venous pooling in their lower legs was measured, as these variables, in combination, may contribute to suspension trauma. An exciting initial observation is that the majority of W position participants were able to complete the experiment, while all but one of the control group participants had to see suspension early due to meeting cutoff criteria for pre-suspension trauma symptom development. However, statistical analysis and differences in individual variables between groups are yet to be determined. With limited clinical research about suspension trauma, this pilot study has the potential to significantly impact suspension trauma patients, fire departments, pre-hospital care providers, and hospital services, as well as various recreational and vocational climbing organizations, by streamlining aerial rescues as a standard protocol. Thank you.
Our nuclear world looks nothing like it did 3 decades ago. North Korea has the ability to hit American cities with nuclear weapons, and new exciting technologies are dominating our headlines. For some, the remedy to the problems like these is missile defense, and no country has subscribed to this technology more than the United States. Since the early 2000s, the US has deployed something called the Ground-Based Mid-Course Defense, a national ballistic missile defense system aimed at preventing nuclear weapons hitting American cities. With over 2 decades of development and tens of billion dollars, the catch is we don't actually know if this system can protect American cities. And that leaves us in the field with a significant research problem. I'm calling it the data gap. And this is a problem for analysts and is simply that we are not provided with the right data to be able to scrutinize this system and its policy implications. What we do know is that GBMD has been tested 19 times for interception. Of those 19 times, it has only succeeded in 11 tests. That leaves an SSPK, or a single shot probability of kill, of about 57%. That is terrible for a system required to do the job it's asked of. And the key risk here is that overconfidence in GBMD could lead to reckless decision making. In a crisis with, let's say, North Korea, it's possible that decision makers will have overconfidence in their defenses and they could actually fail if push comes to shove. Additionally, runaway defense spending is fueled by baseless assumptions on effectiveness. Missile defenses like GBMD as well strategically inspire arms racing, where countries pursue hypersonic weapons or proliferate their stockpiles in order to restore a sense of credibility. To address these problems, my research proposes a quantitative solution, where I use applied mathematics to model this system in two distinctive scenarios. These scenarios replicate missile defense policy, and they place the system in the situations where the missile defense agencies say it's designed to work. The model itself is drawn from a paper in the literature, and is really cool because it gives me the versatility to control the variables and adjust them based on the scenario. We know that by 2028, the total number of interceptors the GBMD will have is 64. So, if the model tells me I need more than 64 interceptors, I will be able to say how and to what extent that system will fail in the future. The purpose of these simulations is to provide the field with operational data that we would never be able to achieve without fighting an actual war. By arming ourselves with this information, we may begin to make progress on limiting the risks of miscalculation in a crisis and also bring missile defense spending back down to earth. My name's Harry Spencer, and this was my PGT in 3. Thank you very much.
The power you have over people lies in your index finger. You might have heard that looking at an object in the room and watching to see if your date follows your eye gaze is a way to tell if they like you by paying attention to you. But there is a better way to test their attention. Your visual attention is sometimes drawn overtly with your knowledge, but often it is drawn covertly without you being aware of it. Previous research has found that people covertly pay more attention to a pointing index finger than they do directional eye gaze or head motion. In addition, participants pay more attention to targets pointed at with an index finger, but not those pointed at with a fist or pointing pinky finger. Up to now, it's not known exactly why pointing is such a strong cue of attention. No one has yet tested whether the shortened distance to the target of the pointing cue compared to a gaze cue is the cause. It's actually quite surprising that an extended index finger on an outstretched arm captures other people's attention more than eye gaze does. After all, we use our eyes and the eye expressions of others all the time. It is possible pointing is so strong simply because the body moves closer, spatially, physically, to what you are pointing at. However, it might be that humans automatically look in the direction that somebody points due to something special about the index finger pointing. So in my research, I want to find out which of these two possible explanations is more likely. If the first hypothesis, then holding out an object but not a pointing index finger, should attract the same amount of attention as pointing does. If it's the second hypothesis, however, then pointing cues should attract the same amount of attention no matter where they appear in space. In the bottom left corner is a pointing condition of my experiment, pointing to the target letter. Time to detect the target after the cue presentation was measured. I tested two previously made cartoon figures, eye gaze and pointing out cues, against two new figures to test the hypotheses. One holds out a flower, made from the same elements as the hand, out the same distance as the pointing finger, and one which points a finger over the body, and so is no closer to the target than eye gaze is. My results show that participants reacted faster to targets on the same side that was cued in both of the pointing conditions, but they were not faster to respond to targets when attention was cued with eye gaze or holding out a flower. I conclude then that the pointing index finger is special for directing attention. Knowing how and why we pay attention to pointing cues from this simple experiment helps us understand how we learn from and remember the visual world around us. So next time you want to test if your date is paying attention to you, don't look at the painting on the wall, point to it.